Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for having us here, and thank you to the two gentlemen for being here. Later on, we'll take some of your questions. I guess thinking if you want to put any questions to these two fine gents. Thanks for being here tonight, fellas. Let's start with the here and now. Makes sense, really, to start that way. Bryan, first full season in charge of Yorkshire Carnegie. Without putting pressure on you, a season we're hoping is going to be playoffs and then promotion back to the Premiership, the promised land. How have things been progressing for you over the course of the last 7 or 8 months, do you think, with the squad?
Yeah, I mean, it's a great challenge for me to come across to Yorkshire from 10 years in the Premiership and coming across here to this, you know, it's a great county and people forget how strong it is. So it's gone really well in my view. I think there was a little bit in October that were a bit rocky and certainly a few games I felt we just lacked that little bit of some leadership and confidence to get through that, but certainly we addressed a few things and changed a few things and the last six games have gone really well, but probably this is the business end now. We need to make sure we knock off this next four games and then look at, you know, the playoffs. It's the top four that goes through and ultimately you can finish one off four. We've still got to beat everyone in that last 4 weeks and it's gone really well from my point of view. I think the growing is always there and every week we have to develop. And I think that probably the biggest thing is actually believing that there's a dream at the end of it. I've come here to get in the Premiership, to stay in the Premiership for a long time. And that's going to take a lot of sacrifices around the group and players and staff. And ultimately, we need everyone to come along and support it as well, because it's an expensive business in the top league and we need to generate finance and everything. But on a whole, it's been a great experience for the past 9 months, and you know the next 3 are probably the major ones.
There always seems to be something in professional sport, a speed bump that comes along, and at the moment, like many people in Yorkshire affected by the dreadful floods of Christmas, it's wiped out your Kirkstall training ground. Can you just tell us about what's happened to the training ground and how that's affecting you and the squad now in terms of training and preparing for games?
Yeah, I mean, obviously at Christmas time with all the floods, I think we were, you know, Kirkstall got flooded, obviously, and the changing rooms, the gym area, the medical area, the rubber crumb, the pitches were all covered in probably about 3 or 4 inches of silt, which, you know, legally the players now can't go on because of infection if there's any cuts. And obviously all the facilities are damaged. But to be honest with you, it's not been a huge, you know, hindrance for us. West Park, where we are training, the Rhinos are obviously at another venue, but West Park's been great for us. That we're on our own, there's no one else around, and actually, the players are starting to be, you know, proper people now. They're cleaning the changing rooms afterwards, they wash the dishes after we've eaten dinner and breakfast. And actually, it's quite nice to see them in the kitchen with these big burly men and, you know, doing some home chores. But we haven't had, you know, a huge amount of change for us. I think, as I say, and it's very hard because the Rhinos are so successful and we are trying to emulate a lot of their good things. And sharing a facility with them is sometimes quite awkward. And it's not necessarily blaming anyone, but we have to book in times for gymnasiums or which the rubber crumb if the weather's bad, and sharing the facilities. And for once, it's a chance for me to drive the players that, you know, if you really knuckle down and we want to emulate what the Rhinos have done. And to do that, you have to sacrifice some things. And we've been given an opportunity, in my view, over the last 6 weeks to change some of that. And you know, West Park have been great, and the players have responded, you know, to the change, and I think it's been good for us. So it's not been a huge blow. It's probably helped me focus the players. It's helped the players focus. I'm sure Kev can chat on his own side of it. But for me, it's allowed us a really small part that we take away any excuses. Well, we can't get this or we can't do that. And we have no excuses anymore, which is maybe harder for me.
Yeah, no pressure. Kevin, you better cook or cleaner than up at West Park? What's your forte?
Either, if I'm honest.
Versatile, we should know that, shouldn't we? Good at everything. 3 months since the change of code, seems to have gone by quickly. How are you finding life as a rugby union player?
Yeah, very different. But as expected, it's been pretty well documented, the reasons I went across, but the challenge I expected, I think I'd have been let down if I'd have found it easy and simple. It has thrown some difficulties up, which I expected. One, joining a new dressing room. It's the first time I've had to do it since sort of leaving school. And secondly, trying to learn a completely new game. Now, you look at both sports and you say they're using the same ball. You tackle the same, you pass, you kick the same, but it's so very, very different. And But like I said, it's been the challenge I wanted. My career with the Rhinos was brilliant and I couldn't have asked for a better ending. But to get the opportunity to do something like this, to play a second professional sport at 35, has been brilliant. And the work I've done behind the scenes throughout the Rhinos season in particular, I found myself with a fair bit of free time having completed my Masters in May. And it was about that time that I started to spend a lot more time focusing on the rugby union stuff, and Bryan were fantastic with that behind the scenes, and I think it certainly helped with the transition. I have to say the welcome I got from the team, from the staff, you know, I couldn't have asked for any more. The lads have been fantastic, and they're so giving, and I've been really grateful for the time and support that people have put my way.
Well, let's talk about your 2015 switch codes. Treble winning season with Leeds Rhinos, master's degree from here at Leeds Beckett University, runner-up in BBC Sports Personality of the Year. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm sure you would join me in applauding Kevin on what's been an incredible year. Still not quite sure how you fitted all that in, so well done for just doing that. How do you reflect on it all now?
Look, I think there's something missing there, isn't there? 2016, be quite happy getting promoted, won't we, pal? That'd be the absolute icing on the cake. But yeah, it was a really nice year. It was nice to go on holiday at the end of the grand final. We played the Saturday and we flew out Monday morning. It was nice to go away for the first time, probably in my life, but certainly since I've had a family, where I've been able to go away and I've had no baggage, whether that be a game that's lingered or the way it ended didn't quite fit, but it was brilliant. So to go away and be there 100% physically but 100% mentally as well, it meant my kids and my missus got the best of me, and that was really important, that I could draw a line under it and head to union fully focused and ready for the challenge. The stuff that come after sort of the grand final, the spotty stuff was completely out of the blue. I was delighted to be in the 12, to be the first rugby league player ever nominated was, you know, when you look at some of the greats we've had, you know, my hero growing up was Ellery, and to know that Ellery wasn't even nominated is something I'm, you know, quite humbled by. So to be in the 12 I was delighted with, but then to get in the top three was a very, very special night, and it was nice to get another night with the Rhinos, to say goodbye and thank you to a lot of those lads. Played with alongside many of them for 10, 15 years now, so you know, certainly wish them all the best and I'll support them this year, but to get one last time to say thank you to them was great, and like I said, we've got one hell of a challenge in front of us now, so as well as trying to continue learning and continue getting better every day and every game, there's a big goal in front of us.
Wish you the best of luck with that goal, which we'll talk about more later on. That Rhino squad, obviously, that treble last season was absolutely incredible, but it's not just been a one-season wonder. It has been, what, a decade, an era of success for that Rhinos team with different coaches, different players. What has been the key to having such a special era of team?
Oh, there'd be a whole host of different things, but I think if I had to pick one thing, it'd be the people that have been there. Look, you can have the best facilities, you can have the best environment, the best culture, but the people create all that, and there's certainly been some rocky times throughout those 10, 15 years, but the quality of people that have been involved there, been able to come through it and stick together, and I know that when other clubs may be pointing the fingers at each other, the first thing that group did was look in the mirror and try and fix it for themselves, so you know, that would be the most important thing. Look, we've been in an environment where there's been a fantastic fan base. The support we've had has been incredible. The coaches we've had along the way has been brilliant. And the quality of player, never mind the person, but the quality of player that have been there and been recruited, have had so much determination to win trophies and get over the line. So difficult to pick one thing out, but like I said, in my opinion, what makes any organisation is the quality of people you've got, and irrespective of how good rugby players they were some of the best people I've met in my life.
And looking at last season in particular, sometimes sports people talk about moments in games or seasons where they know they were going to win and they were going to do it, or they know the opposition was spent and weren't going to beat them. Was there a moment or an event in the season where something just maybe in the back of your mind went, this is going to be a special one, we're going to do something this season like that treble?
I think if you look at the season as a whole for me, it started off okay, and then I was left out of the team for 3 or 4 games, and I think at that point you're probably thinking the opposite. It had been announced that I was switching codes, and but I think something I'm pretty proud of is the fact that throughout my career I've faced adversity and I've been able to drag myself off the floor and come back and try and make it work. So that last 6 weeks in particular, you know, the win at Wembley, the win at Huddersfield, which was unbelievable with all the scoring in them last few seconds, and then obviously the grand final. To have that lead at half time was the biggest lead we've had in a grand final at half time, and to have that turned on its head within 9 minutes, to be behind and looking around at the lads and know how shot they were, how desperate we were at that stage. But I suppose that if you wanted something to sum up the last 15 years of being a Rhino, it'd be that moment where, you know, what we played for that next 31 minutes wasn't pretty, but it was all about character and grit, and we were able to make it work.
Bryan, the Rhinos, a team that's always kind of been there to shot at over the last 10 years. You've played in some very successful sides, and now as a coach, you're Yorkshire Carnegie. You're a big fish, and you're expected to win most of your games. How do you manage pressure and cope with that and make sure that you get the best performances out of a team when you are under pressure?
I think you have to focus on yourself. So I think a lot of the times you get distracted by external things, whether it be conditions, referee, or, you know, the opposition. And I think you tend to worry about what they're going to bring and what they're going to ask you to do, or what picture they paint, and you forget about the qualities that we are or you are. Individually, unit-based and union, obviously, you know, Kev is learning lots of different things, but ultimately, if you do your job and you do that well, then the focus is, you know, your adjustment to what they are. You don't need to adjust your own game that much. You just need to do it really well. And I think, for me, obviously, watching rugby league a lot as a youngster coming through from the Borders, where I was brought up in Scotland, rugby league was there through Alan Tate, or, you know, people like that that I knew from a kid growing up, that league union was the mix. But ultimately, characters within the team drive the team, and then people, there's doers and there's people that just go along the way. And I think all the way along is just do my job for the team, in the team. And everybody has that mindset. There is people that are special, and there is people that will turn up and do something special. But that team doesn't function off that. The team functions off the core values, the core skills, the core unit stuff that I think are just fundamental. And you look at recruitment and you look at players, and you sign a player on his talents, and then you ask him to change and be like someone else or improve his skill. And I'm not the biggest fella, and so I was always mindset, I could pass a ball, I could kick, I could piss people off because I could nag them the whole time. And that was my strength, and I always focused on my strength. And people used to say to me, oh, why can't you be like Gary Armstrong or someone, and he was bigger and stronger and he would physically take on people. I was never blessed to do that, but I was smarter than them, I thought quicker than them. So I always just used that, and that was my strength, so I stuck at that. When people told me, Jim Telfer told me years ago that I would never play for Scotland at the age of 14, 15, I was too small. And so for me, I was there to prove him wrong every single day. And eventually he picked me right up until I retired after 60 odd games. And so I knew it was my challenge was there to just do what I could do. I could pass the ball better than other people. So I was always going to be that way. And to have a strong mindset was that was my strength, and I was going to stick to it. So I had a focus in that team, and that was to make sure that I could make the game play quickly. And so I think in a general part, it was stick to your strengths. Don't always look at the things you do bad. Highlight them, but make through the things that you're good at, you're really good at, and everything else will creep up rather than be average at everything else. So that was a big thing for me, and it still is. You know, I want players to be the best. I want Kev to be one of the best at picking or someone through a hole like he did in his rugby league, that can transfer to rugby union. I'm not interested in Kev being the best rugby union player. I'm interested in Kev being the best player that he can offer the team and keep doing that, like everybody else. The other youngsters that are coming through, they've got qualities that I want to keep in them, to grow them. And then off the back of it, we'll highlight the weak things, but they're the hard parts. You know, if you can turn your weakness to your biggest strength, then great, but you've probably dropped off in something else. So for me, the strength of the team is the fact it's a team. We've all got a part to play. Me as a coach has got a part to play. Me at this time of the year, it's me as a manager, because, you know, there's 20-odd lads out of contract. It's a tough time, because some of them are going to lose a job. They're going to go home and tell their wife and kids they've got to find another job in another part of the country. That's never easy, dealing with that, but that's part of the industry, and sadly, that's just the way it is. But if there's honesty attached to that, that keeps the group tight as well. So, you know, there's a lot of balances in there, and everyone in here will take different things out of what they want to be successful at. For me, it was always about being whatever I was good at, I was going to be the best at. And if I was going to be the best passer in the world, that was my goal in that time, because I could never be 6 foot. Even though I tried, I couldn't, you know. Laughing at that's very hard. But no, generally I couldn't, so I had to accept that and use other avenues of being successful.
Got a vision of you being the first person with, like, high-heeled rugby boots trying to make
there,
it.
Yeah, tell you, don't knock it, I've tried it. Them studs were long in my day. I was 5'8", I said.
Kevin, you've already touched on sports personality of the year and saying what it was like to have the Rhinos over in Belfast for that event, but what was the whole experience like? And come on, let's name drop. Who were you rubbing shoulders with when you were over there? Or who were the ones that wanted your autograph, maybe?
No, the whole experience was really, really humbling, and I have to say it was incredibly busy. December, Phil Daly, our media manager, had me here, there and everywhere. And when you're trying to learn a new sport and play, it was very, very demanding.
And you played the day before, didn't you? At London
played
Scottish.
The day before, and I have to say, honestly, travelling down to London on the Friday, we were playing the Saturday, sport was on the Sunday, and the only thing I wanted to get right in the whole weekend was the game, because I knew that if we got the game and we got the win, that it'd set the weekend off, and thankfully the team performed, we got the result. But yeah, sport was great. I've been fortunate enough to be at a few now. I met some fantastic sports people from a whole variety of sports. With it being in Belfast logistically, a lot of the footballers in particular are and rugby, top rugby union players weren't there because of playing that weekend. But I have to say, the beauty of being there, in particular for those for the Rhinos lads, especially the younger lads who may be looking elsewhere and thinking about what comes next for them, whether it be, do they move to rugby union in the 20s? Do they go to the NRL? Do they try a different sport? What was really nice and humbling was the amount of different sports and sports people that came over and chatted and had a real interest in the game, especially the footballers, you know, doing a lot of travelling and being in hotels. Friday nights, Thursday nights, they watch Super League and they all have the team. And best example of that I can probably give you from the night was Martin O'Neill, the Republic of Ireland boss, an absolute massive Rhinos fan, and nobody'd know that. You know, spent most of the night drinking with the lads and became an adopted Rhino. So, like I said, there were some fantastic people there, and you end up chatting with people and we end up being in circles you never thought you'd be, but probably more important for me, being with those Rhinos lads for one last time was more important than rubbing shoulders with somebody from football or athletics.
You've been a few times, Bryan. What have your experiences been like there?
Yeah, never to the level of Kev, obviously. I was just part of the Scottish lads that had been there a few times. Similar kind of thing. I love all different sports, and I think you know, I do see it as very humbling. I would never even, you know, throughout my career think that I was anything special. I was just a joiner that came from the building site, was fortunate enough to play rugby, and going to these events, you look around and you see people and you just think, you know, especially the individual people for me, that, you know, whether it's the tennis players, the boxers, anybody like that, anything that does an individual sport, I feel is it's such inner strength to compete. I can have a bad day on a rugby pitch and my mates can help me out. But you look at some of these people, the athletes that put that effort in, and, you know, as I say, I've been a couple of times and I was just more in awe of the whole thing and kept myself to myself, enjoyed the beer afterwards. And again, just like Kev, really, I, the people I was there with was great. But in general terms, it's just an amazing thing to see as many sports people that are normal and, you know, felt normal in that environment. And that was the pleasing thing, to see people that are just normal.
Incredible achievement to come run up to Andy Murray in particular. What do you think it's done for the game of rugby league?
I'm not quite sure. I think we'll probably see with the start of Super League next week. But, you know, you'd like to think that, I know I was representing rugby league, but you'd like to think around the country, you know, being up there on that stage may just inspire one person to pick a rugby ball up. Whatever code that may be, I think it's good for either game. In rugby league in particular, for it to be given that stage and that spotlight, having had year after year where it said its usual 4 or 5 seconds on the show, to have a couple of minutes, to have a team on the stage, to have someone nominated, just to give it a different spotlight, I think is, hopefully gives the sport a shot in the arm. I think on the back of a successful 2015 with the story with the Rhinos winning the treble, with England winning the series against New Zealand, I think British Rugby League and Super League is in a really strong position, and you know, hopefully myself being on the stage added a tiny bit to that, and you know, I hope rugby league goes through the roof in 2016.
Yeah, I think we'd all say hear with that. So you've decided to become a rugby union player. Why do that? Why not just finish at the high, at the very top, retire, no regrets, having been a rugby league legend, and just stop? Why did you want to take on this challenge?
It's something I've always wanted to do. I think the opportunity to play two professional sports is an unbelievable challenge. I know how similar the sports look, but they are very, very different. But all I've ever known from being 13, apart from studying, has been the Rhinos. And throughout my career, I've had different opportunities, NRL, different Super League clubs, and rugby union. And it's always been something that I've had a desire to go and have a go and see if I could make a success of it. I have to say, there was probably only one club that I was ever interested in joining. And it's easy for me to say that now because I'm there, but you know, I looked at everybody else who'd left the Rhinos and wherever they'd gone, but there was only a handful of them that had made a success from leaving Leeds. And some of that was due to having to move the family and relocate, and the fact that I could stay in Leeds with a whole host of players that I knew already, having shared a training ground for 10 years. There were some of those friendships and relationships already in place. Because I knew all about the history and traditions of the club, I knew where they'd been, what they'd been through, that made the decision a whole lot easier. But I just wanted the challenge. I just wanted one last challenge before I have to get a real job. One last go at something, you know, while I'm still fit and able to go and have a crack. And the opportunity arose. You know, I didn't go and do it at 18. I didn't go and do it in my mid-20s. I give everything possible I could to the Rhinos. And as it panned out, you know, I didn't know at the time there was no better time to leave, to move on. But this is it's been a huge carrot to go and try something, to try and help this team get promoted, to try and get this team back in the top flight where they deserve to be. And when it all boiled down, when I looked and I was reflecting on my career, and I looked how I wanted to look back, and I didn't want to be that guy who looked back on his career and he had some if-onlys or some buts. And there were one last thing I wanted to do, and that was go and play professional rugby union at the top level. And that was the question I asked myself. Could I finish my playing career having not done it? And I don't think it just sat right with me.
Brian, how did you feel when it was first mentioned that we might try and sign Kevin Sinfield and try and convert him to rugby union. What was your reaction?
There's a bit of good luck to you changing them last last year. Put it all in my head. Now, I mean, I've known of Kev throughout his whole sort of rugby league career. As I say, I love rugby league as much as many other people watching it. And I knew, I'd known of Kev through some friends of mine that had played at Leeds Tykes before, so I'd know what kind of character Kev was off the pitch. And ultimately, I played alongside ex rugby league players and Jason Robinson at Sale and Apollo Perlini, coach Big Leslie Vinacola at Gloucester, which was, I'm sure Kev was going to be easy compared to Big Les. He was a handful. Henry Paul was there obviously as well. So, and I knew Kev's character. So I knew that over that time when I came here last April, it was already decided, whether it had been announced or not, it was already decided that Kev was going to give it a go. And we touched base virtually every week, where it going through videos, phone calls, tricky times when he's not selected and what have you with the Rhinos. So it was an easy switch or an easy look at it. But I think the part of playing number 10 was the difficult thing. A lot of these players that I've come across have played either outside backs or in the forwards in terms of Burgess came in and Andy Farrell came in, so Kev playing a number 10 was a really tricky situation for him. But the fact is that we didn't complicate anything, we made things very simple. It does, a lot of things we do cross over, just positioning and depth and stuff is the only thing that's a big work on. So for me it was a challenge and one that I knew as a person would go well. And ultimately, that dream goal of getting to where we want to get to, me as a coach, the players, the group itself, and Kev's got this desire that he wants to, help the group achieve this goal in 2016 and 26th of May, being in that Premiership. And I've never thought anything. I've not complicated it. I think the easiest part for me would to say, "Oh, you can or you can't." Well, let's just clean all the rubbish out and let's have a go. Let's give it a crack and. That's how I've seen it. I've not complicated it for Kev. He'd maybe say different, but I've tried to make it as simple and as easy as possible because I do believe the games are simple. Sometimes coaches make it complicated, but I think in general terms, he's a good bloke, which is the key part to it all. I think good people generally get good things done to them, and I'm sure come that 2016 and as I say, 25th, 26th of May, we'll be hopefully drinking a beer or two after that evening.
Yeah, hopefully so. They are two totally different sports. I think the only thing they have in common is the word rugby in them. More players on the pitch, the breakdown situation, a bit more stop-start. What has been the biggest challenge to you?
There'd be a few, actually. I mentioned it earlier, the new dressing room. Being accepted. Being understood, I suppose. Understanding them as well. But you find that rugby players are very, very similar of either code, and how welcoming people were was brilliant and really comforting. You know, that first morning when I walked in, I felt like I was my first day at high school. I thought, what's coming here? I didn't know where to sit in the changing rooms. Thought I'd find my bag in the bin. I didn't know what had happened, but they were brilliant. So initially, that dressing room environment. Since then, conditions, playing back in the winter again. I've not done that since we're 15. Albeit, if I was with the Rhinos, it'd be in pre-season now and we'd be having friendlies. But week in, week out, playing in ankle-deep mud, takes some getting used to again. And then probably the last one and the funniest, which was a bit of a reality shock, really. You make a tackle in rugby league, you get up and you either become a marker or you get back in the defensive line. You make a tackle in rugby union and you're fair game. And anybody can hit you from anywhere. So just getting used to that, getting used to being hit when you're probably not expecting it. So actual rugby stuff with a ball in my hands is what I'm used to. And I think early days there was some issues with my positioning things that are instinctive as a rugby league player that I've done since I was seven. Suddenly I had to break some of those habits to become and to fit in. So there was that as well, but probably the funniest was being hit.
Have you been given a few rake marks? Have you, the boys in the ruck situation, a few stamps? Or been
touch
okay?
Wood, no, not yet. but I think the boys have looked after me really well again. They've tried to keep me out of there, and when I've been caught in there, you know, there's been a big hand that have quickly pulled me out of there. So the boys have been great, and Bruce's advice and guidance about when and when not to get in there, and what happens when you get in there, and how quickly you have to get out before those big size 15s come, has been great advice. So.
And as much as you've been obviously having to coach Kevin, without trying to give him too much of a big head, what has Kevin brought, an experienced rugby player, and you've got a very young side overall? Yeah. Has that been the biggest thing?
Yeah, I mean, the funny thing, I'll just touch on what Kev was touching on at the end there. We had a game at Munster away, and that was funny because I'm standing, and for me it's new as well, being in, you know, Premiership's all about big stadiums, you're in a box, you're taken away from all the fans, what have you. We go across to Kinsale in Munster and play, and typical Celtic League side, just want to belt people off the ball. So I'm sat behind the posts, and I'm watching the first couple of rucks. Kev makes a tackle, gets up, and then suddenly this guy flies in, tackles him off the ball, and Kev's like, what's going on? And I'm thinking, oh, Jesus, normally wouldn't bother me, but I'm standing laughing at the back of the post, thinking, look at him there, look at him, laughing, just because everything, what are you doing? And it's just that whole mindset. And the pitch, that was the first time they'd had a professional game at their ground. They'd never used the lights before. It was knee-deep in mud. It was windy, and I'm thinking, Kev's just come from Super League Grand Final, Old Trafford, to this rugby club. And then just getting belted off the ball, for me, was pretty pleasing, just to see him. Just not in a nice way, get up and deal with it as well, and not get too bothered by it, and coming in at the end of it thinking, was that all right? Was that all right? And I'm saying, nah, you got to get out of there, Kev. But, yeah, I mean, I think what he has done, and I said to him from day one, I'm going to put you in the deep end. You're going to go out and you're going to play. I'm not going to be this, you know, coach you and train you up to be an instant rugby player in 6 weeks when you've had training sessions. Training is nothing compared to playing at any level. And, you know, it prepares you to play, but nothing gives you the real balance to getting out there. So we said from day one, get out there, make mistakes, learn from it. He's a good learner, he's quick at that, and he adapts very well. I think the pleasing thing for me is that he does not complicate it. As he says to me, give me a game plan, let me run it. If you want to change it, we'll do that next week, or we'll do it in the sessions. Don't ask me, coming from another sport, to change it within the game, because I don't know it enough yet. I'll pick it up along the way. And that's what he's done. He hasn't complicated it. And we've got some big daft units, you know, in that our team, 135 kilograms, 6'6". They're not the best at turning and moving in mud. So when they're going one way, they're going one way, and they stay that way for a while. So for Kev, just keep encouraging him to keep folding and moving. And that's easy. And he understands that. He doesn't complicate it. And he's very humble with the players. And I think he could easily have been perceived that he'd come up, you know, nobody thought that, but fall into that little bit of a trap. The simpler for Kev's been the easiest and the most efficient for us as a team. He's playing a key position, so he needs the key parts. And I think what he has done is calm the boys down. He doesn't panic about making an error. He moves on very quickly. And I think some people do dwell on errors and mistakes a long time. So then they come out and try and do something different or rectify an error. Whereas Kev doesn't, it goes back to the page one and just builds it up again. And that's probably the pleasing side of someone that's come into the game. Mm. Whether he's felt that way in rugby league or not, Kev can only answer that. But in rugby union terms, he makes it clear for them big fellas that are his bread and butter. And when he needs protecting, generally you've got to look after them. So he's done that really well.
And where you're starting to make it sound like this is your life, Kevin, but just want to talk about one final thing that you did last year, and that was earn your Masters in Sports Business here at Leeds Beckett University to add to the degree you got in 2008. Why did you want to study for a Masters? Why do you feel education is important when you're a professional sports person?
Probably stems right the way back from when I was 16. I made my debut for the Rhinos the day after I got my GCSE results. And I got offered a full-time contract then. I'd already enrolled at Oldham Sixth Form College to go and do my A-levels, and all I ever wanted to be was a rugby player. And to get this offer of a full-time contract was the direction I wanted to go in. My parents, being very smart, advised me that the best thing to do was to go and do my A-levels and continue playing part-time, which is what I did. And it was the worst 2 years of my life. But so since then, I always had a plan to go to university. Thankfully, Leeds Beckett have always been very accommodating to Leeds rugby. And my first degree, which took 5 years part-time, was with three other players. And really enjoyable. At the time, I had no children and was pretty easy to fit everything in. So come 3 years ago, when I decided to set out on my master's, alongside Jamie Peacock, both got children, but both realised that, I mentioned it earlier, when I finished playing, I have to get a real job, and my first degree probably didn't prepare me for what I'd like to do after rugby. So I decided to come back, and there were some really, really difficult moments. You know, I can remember driving home, probably about 6 or 8 weeks in. We were studying on a Thursday evening. It was 5 till 9, and was playing Friday nights with the Rhinos. So I'd been there all day Thursday, left home at 6 o'clock in the morning, two kids at home. Stay through during the day. I was always juggling whether I should go home back to Oldham or stay through during the afternoon. More often than not, I stayed through, and I'd be getting home at 10:15 at night on a Thursday, and I remember thinking, is it worth it? Is it worth all this at this moment in time? You know, trying to fit all the reading in, trying to do the assignments, trying to get everything in place. And it was really tough. And it took me back to when I was 16 and the A-levels, and knowing how I had to juggle things back then. And having finished it, I'm so glad I've done it. I'm so glad that I pushed on and got through it, because honestly, after that first 6 or 8 weeks, I'd had enough. I just wanted to be a rugby player, and I wanted to, but it's one of those things, you know. Casey's here tonight. We had some fantastic teachers and lecturers, and again, the help and support I got from the uni was brilliant. But it is tough. It is tough, but as I found throughout my career, that more often than not, the most difficult route has brought me the best results or best rewards. Not in terms of money, but certainly in terms of satisfaction. And I'm really glad it's finished.
Well, again, congratulations on that. Brian, obviously, University of Hard Knocks you went to, wasn't it, in your career. What about your career, and particularly your playing days? As we heard earlier from Helen, 3 World Cups, obviously a lot of success in Scotland, played in the Premiership, captain of your country as well, now coached at various different clubs. What are the kind of standout moments?
Yeah, I was totally different when I was brought up in a farming community in the Borders. I left school at 15, started as a joiner the next day on the building site. Had 8 years as a joiner, working 54 hours a week. Fortunately, I played rugby, obviously, and trained. So I was from a total different background, and I got offered I played international rugby in 1993 as an amateur, where we had to work until the Monday to Wednesday evening, and then drove to Edinburgh, played, and then obviously played international Saturday. I'd have to train from my club on a Sunday morning at 10 o'clock because Jim Telfer made us train at club rugby, and then obviously back in the building site. So I was pretty totally different from a lot of the youngsters nowadays, and obviously with the game turned professional. So I was fortunate to go through the whole rugby sort of element. And I guess I always feel that I had 2 older brothers, and we all played in the same club team, and I was the one that got the accolades of international rugby. And, you know, I don't complicate it too much. I've been lucky. 10 years I played for my country, and I had the choice to stay on or take that time to come out of it and try and enjoy club rugby. Because I think I was away 22 weeks that year in 2003 and from home, and suddenly you have a total different mindset. The highlights and the World Cups 1995, when the game was still amateur, was unbelievable. To go to another country like that and play in such a big thing. They had just come back into rugby union in 1994, so that was huge. I can remember that quarter final, and people like remember Jonah Lomu and watching on the Friday. We trained at the stadium And then I seen these lads in the stadium sitting at the bottom end, and obviously I'd watched Jonah prior to that, and then seen him sitting there actually in his vest, the headphones on, and I was thinking, look at the size of him. And I was tiny, you know, I was a short arse. But and probably about 10 stone, and he was rocking in at 18 stone 5, 6 foot 5. I'm thinking, he's not even going to notice if I try and tackle him. But, you know, it was a great experience to be around the whole hype of him being involved in games. And we lost in the quarterfinals to New Zealand. And then it just progressed, really. Gavin Hastings told me after that game that I would captain my country. And, you know, fortunately I did for 20-odd occasions. And the whole time I never felt I was any different. I would go back to the building site. I would go back with the lads and be them. I wish I had stuck in at school. And I generally do, you know, I think... You look at, you know, youngsters nowadays, and they don't pay enough attention to their education or what they will do if you break some bones and you don't get to play again. And that doesn't mean that being a tradesman isn't a bad thing, because it was a great thing. It gives me someone that I've got for the rest of my life, and I can go back to it. You know, the highlights of playing club rugby in Scotland or 1999, I'd played and I'd finished the World Cup, and I'd made a decision then. I'd been playing senior rugby for 10 years then, because I started young, just like Kev, really, and I hadn't really challenged myself from that point of view, so I then decided to move to France and live for a couple of years. So I played for Narbonne in France after the World Cup. I went in the summer prior to it, and I've got to say that was probably the best thing I'd done, because I had to go back to a learning process of the language. I'd never done it at school. So that was great for me, learning French as a Scotsman calling line-out codes in France. I had some strange looks from the French players, I can tell you, but it was a wonderful experience. It set me up. In my mindset, it opened me up a little bit. And then I think, just as a general, I've been really lucky. 2003, to finish my last game as captain of my country, I was really fortunate. I had a good group of men around me, as we talked about before, Gregor Townsend, Tom Smith, Kenny Logan, Scott Murray. They were great men to have. And I knew, as I say, at that time, I was going to knock it in the head. I could enjoy it. I can have, you know, some fun times enjoying that last sort of trip away with them for 8 weeks. We were together, and just being with a group of lads that I'd been with for the last 10 years, or previous 10 years playing with, was great for me. And then, you know, as it unfolds, I just feel very fortunate. I'm lucky. As I say, I'm not any different from anyone else. I was just lucky along the way, I think. And then obviously turn into coaching, and it's a total different animal altogether. I was going to work for... So I had my back fixed 2005. I had to retire early. I was going to work for Sky Sports, doing a bit of rugby punditry, and then Dean Ryan convinced me 4 weeks after my surgery, getting that cage put in my back, that I would come and coach in Gloucester. I was like, what am I going to Gloucester for? I hate it. They used to shout and spit at me when I was in the touchline. So, yeah, I had great, wonderful 7 years there. Got to Premiership final, won the league twice, European quarterfinals, three other trophies which we competed for. So had a wonderful time, and then back to Sale, where it all started in England. But you know, the real challenge as a coach is this one for me, because I've made a decision to come out of the Premiership and come to this part of the country and Yorkshire, and try and get in that and keep the young kids here, some old fellas here, and and keep them in this part of the country. I think it's such a wealth of sport and ability. It's a shame that people leave and don't get a chance to sample rugby union. And this part, like Paul Hill's just left, and you know, credit to Paul, he's got picked for England, and you know, I really hope he does well. I was trying to convince him to stay when I came, but that's life. And you know, my career's been, I would say it's been up and it's been downs when I've been dropped, and Ian McGeachan didn't pick me for the Lions in 97. Well, he did in 97. I got injured, sadly, playing for the Barbarians, but 2001 and 2005 he didn't. So for the people who think that we're friends, we're not. I don't like Geach, but on a serious note, you know that. But generally, he's been great in my career as well. But I've been very lucky, and I'm humbled to what I've achieved. But this is the biggest challenge I've had as a coach so far, and one that I'm loving. But I certainly sometimes, when I was having to train about 4 weeks ago, when we had a couple of injuries around the scrum halves, it was nearly the oldest half-back partnership in world rugby of about 100. And Eli's about his age, by the way. He just looks young.
25.
But yeah, it's you know, I've been fortunate, and it's not ended yet. We've got a real challenge on our hands. And, you know, as I've said earlier, come May, I want it to be that way. And my job now is to convince the group that I've got there playing that believing in little things and doing the little things really, really well, we'll get there.
And the great thing about both colleges of rugby is the characters that have been in the game, are still in the game, and the personalities you have. Kevin, who are the kind of characters and the kind of people that have stood out that you've played with or played against over your years? I'm sure there's a few there.
Yeah, if we go back to league, there'd probably be four or five, and that'd be the core group that I've spent the last 10 or 15 years with. So you look at Rob Burrow, Danny Maguire, Jamie Jones and JP. Albeit Jamie was with Bradford until 2005, he spent 10 years with the Rhinos. So those four in particular have had a huge impact on not only myself but the team and how successful we've been. All very, very different, but great characters. If I look at my short time in rugby union so far, there are some real characters there as well. The relationships I've been able to build with some of those Rhinos boys will stand the test of time, and I'm hoping that, it's in the early stages, but I'm hoping some of these relationships in rugby union will likewise grow and flourish. My relationship with Brush has been fantastic. The work and support I've had has been incredible. And then when I look at the squad and I look around, we've got a player who plays with Carnegie who's 37, Dean Schofield, and he's been around the game. He's from Stockport, which isn't too far from me in Oldham. And he talks about places, and I've never heard anybody talk about the same places as me, because nobody's ever from that sort of neck of the woods who plays professional rugby. But he's had a couple of years in Toulon. He's won things at Sale. Got a brilliant CV and he's a real character in the dressing room. So you add to that the mix of some of the young guys we've got coming through. We've got some fantastic young players coming through at Carnegie. I think that mix that people often talk about of senior players and juniors that are very, 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 very talented, certainly evident there. So I've really enjoyed that. Are you after some funny stories, because there's kids in here?
Yeah, there are no any PG ones. You have a think. What about you, Ryan? Particularly from the amateur days, you must have had quite a few.
Jesus, certainly clean amateur ones,
please.
I can't
yeah,
tell.
Yeah, before the watershed.
I've got to admit, I was probably one of the worst at winding things up or doing things that I shouldn't have done. There was a time we used to have a bus driver called Dennis. With Dennis for the whole 10 years that he was the national team bus driver, and his life was torture when I was around generally, in a nice way. I never bad to him, but it was things like, he was always first in the food queue. He would never wait for the lads to come in from training. So it was myself and another player called Gary Armstrong, and because we were brought up in farms and HGV, we used to steal the bus. So it would be parked at Murrayfield, so either me or Gary would get in, because he'd leave the keys in it, so we'd drive the bus round to another part and leave it and hide it. So he'd come out panicking, running up and down. You could see him on the security cameras, panicking. Sandwich, whatever, banana, whatever. And the boys wouldn't even finish training. Dennis is like, oh. So there's bits of that that him, he used to go to the hotel and he'd be sitting there at the hotel. And in Dalmahoy, you could take your controls from your TV and point it at the window outside. So Dennis would be sitting there on the edge of the bed like that. He'd be watching the telly and I'd be outside changing it. And ideally there's an adult channel that occasionally crops up. So that probably happened once a day, twice a day maybe. Put in cling film in his toilet seat. So when he has a pee, he's like, whoa! So all that kind of stuff that you're meant to do when you're on tour. Kenny Logan, who I shared with lots, he used to, obviously, rugby lads just get clothes off, walk around the hotel room. He'd be in there, and the minute he put shampoo in his head when he was in the bath, classic hot chocolate behind him in the bath with him. So as it comes out, he's, oh, yeah, shouting, get the kettle on, aye. So I'm rubbing the hot chocolate around the bath, and it's all in his, oh, what's going on here? So little things like that go on. And then a strange one, not strange, but like going back to teams and work ethic. 2002, we were playing South Africa. We'd never beaten them in 34 years or something, so... I was captain. We had a poor game against, I think it was Romania or Portugal the week before. I hadn't played well in November. And then I said to McGeechan and Telfer that I wanted to take the lads for a beer. Just a couple of beers on the Wednesday night prior to the test match. And there was little bits in there. Again, somehow we simply managed to get some footage of them training as well, which was great. So we watched them train and then got a game plan against it. So on the Wednesday, there was a lot of boys were a bit nervy. Nobody expected us to do well. So I said, right, let's all meet. My main mind, sort of boys around, they took each group, booked a restaurant in Edinburgh. And we said, we'll meet in this pub at whatever time, 11 o'clock. Jesus, quarter to one, half two, we're all still in there guzzling away. That you're not meant to do in the professional era. But we were all in there. Every one of the players stayed till that time, 2 o'clock. We were off on the Thursday. We all met at 10 o'clock in the hotel the next morning and said, right, you know, nobody was in any bother because my phone never rang, which was good. But we went and won that day. We won 21-6, and first time in 30 odd years. So some parts of being professional is about being together in a different situation. And that night, we all spoke, we had a great laugh together, we had good fun, there was some mischief, there was mucking around, there was whatever. But ultimately, we knew on the Thursday and the Friday what had happened. And we had to do ourselves proud on the Saturday. And we did, to a man. And it was so sometimes the game is a bit different, and old school stuff does work. Not every week, but it does work. Take note, all right? The players out drinking on Wednesdays. But, you know, that for me, there was some loads of characters out there, and the game should keep them, you know. Even now, when I join in now, I have a bit of banter and I try and muck around with the lads. But I just do it in a way that there is times where you can't carry the pressures on you all the time. You need to see the funny side. When you need to work, you work. When you need to be serious, you be serious. But you can still have a bit of both in there. And, you know, I certainly want to coach like that, but I want to make accountable as well, you know, and that's all it is. So it's a bit of fun as well.
Yeah, Kevin, thought of any stories, or are you much more professional than Bryan?
Yeah, there's a couple that are clean as well, so... I think I got into the habit early, sort of 2000s, when we were in camp, especially with the national team, but certainly with the Rhinos, of you're in an hotel, and at the back of your door, you've got a breakfast order. So I got in the habit of ordering people breakfast, so I wait till they gone to sleep, tick all the things, stick it outside the room before midnight. They get a knock on the door, 6 in the morning, get ordered breakfast. Anyway, it backfired a little bit because I did it to Barry Mack. He was a big guy anyway, and I ordered him all sorts of stuff that wasn't good for him. And most people, when they got the breakfast knock at 5, 6 in the morning, like, come to the door and turn it away. But I'd ordered Barry the worst breakfast that was possible for a guy of his size, donuts and bagels and fried eggs and fried toast. Anyway, the following morning, I got to breakfast and he's tucking in again. And he said, you'll never guess what happened last night. And I said, no, what? He said, got full breakfast came. I said, all right, did you send it back? He went, no, he had the lot. So that was one of them. Anyway, I had a shocker that day, so I never ordered it again. But probably the funniest was Rob Burrow and Kylie. So little and large, always had an ongoing feud. They was always at each other, and then it'd get to a stage where Kylie would get Rob in a chokehold, and then it'd calm down for 3 or 4 months, and Rob would have another go, and he'd chip away until Kylie got him into a chokehold. But my favourite one that Rob did was a hole punching machine, and the bottom that collects all the little white circles of paper is hole punched through 100 sheets of paper and got all these little circular bits, got Kylie's car keys, opened his car up, poured them all in his air vent. So without putting the key in, he's turned the air on full blast, and waited, took Kylie's keys back. Kylie come in after training, put the keys in the engine, and I think about 3 years after, he was still finding little white bits of paper, so that was my favourite.
Brilliant. I'll ask you for your questions in a few moments' time. I suppose just finally, from me, looking at kind of the bigger picture, now you've touched on it a few times, the aim is to get Yorkshire Carnegie into the Premiership. We saw the rebrand of Yorkshire from Leeds Carnegie to Yorkshire Carnegie as they try and embrace the whole county and make Yorkshire a really successful, a top level successful rugby union county, which it is at grassroots level but not professional level. How important is kind of the brand and the club to the whole development of rugby across the county, whether it's bringing through young players in the future or just building that reputation for the game here?
Yeah, I mean, it is a massive challenge. There's no question, you know, the finance now in the Premiership, next year, £7 million per squad, plus marquee players. You know, for us, where we operate under £2 million, to achieve this longevity in there is going to be really tough. The whole part, we do have to try and integrate all the communities from Yorkshire, the rugby clubs. There's, you know, there's what, 80-odd rugby clubs in Yorkshire, bigger than any other county. And the youth and old and everything, that you know, involvement from everyone is massive. Sponsorship, everything. But the big primary goal is what me and Kev are ideally trying to do Monday to Friday is players. If we win, we'll get some rewards, i.e. people will come and watch. People want to be associated with successful sites. That is just the nature of the beast, and we have to try and generate a you know, how we play the game, a brand of the game that needs to be, you know, entertaining for youngsters to want to be and play like. To keep the youth here is massive, because then we're not asking the conveyor belt to churn out 7 or 8 players every year that are going to be quality. So the people that fund the rugby club have, you know, they're going to have to put their neck on the line and try and keep these young men here, so we can actually have icons like Kevin's been for rugby league, staying in Yorkshire. But that's very difficult when somebody will offer them 4, 5, 6 times more than they're on. So, you know, for me, it's involving everyone that wants to be involved in rugby union, or rugby league, or cricket, or cycling, or athletics, wherever, to come and watch us and try and, you know, when fans are in a stadium, you feel that you owe them something. And we have to try and generate that excitement, involvement. Premiership rugby brings that naturally, because we bring people to the stadium that they watch through the England national team. And we want them to come to Carnegie and find it tough. And we can have a chance to have a go at them in our own backyard. And that's what we want. And get them here, then everyone's beatable. But, you know, the challenge is the here and now, and the next 6 months are really important for us.
Kevin, very different animal to Leeds Rhinos. Yorkshire Carnegie is still a relatively young club, a bit of a smaller fish than, say, the Rhinos have always been a big fish in rugby league. But do you see, since you've come in, the foundations are there, the building blocks are there, the club's going in the right direction to eventually achieve what we all hope, and that's sustainable Premiership rugby?
Yeah, very much so. I don't think I'd have joined the club if I didn't agree or didn't buy into the vision that was in place. I think what Brian's touched on there is the amount of young players that Yorkshire is producing rugby union-wise is bigger or larger than any other county out there. So we're certainly producing the talent. Now, keeping hold of them is a different matter. I think the city is big enough to have a fantastic rugby league team and a top-level rugby union team. That's what we're aiming to achieve. But I think with some of the investment that's going on behind the scenes, I think the key is actually getting in the Premiership. I think then people will follow a successful team, like Brian said. I think people will come and watch the likes of Saracens and Bath and Leicester and Sale playing down at the stadium, and that's what we've got to aspire to. So I think it's a club that's growing. Like you said, it's quite new, especially in comparison with the Rhinos, but if the Rhinos has been the model, it's a great model to follow.
And I think just with the academies that we talk about and the importance of developing Yorkshire rugby, the England under-20 squad has just been announced, which in rugby union, I don't know if you know, is a very, very high, prestigious level. And Yorkshire Carnegie has more players in than any Premiership club. So it just shows how important that development is. I've probably bored you enough with my questions. Does anybody have any questions for Bryan and Kevin about any part of their career or their lives? You, sir, in the middle. I have to shout up.
Obviously, the Rhinos the last 10, 15 years have been on TV a hell of a lot, on Sky, on BBC, massive games, grand finals. I was just going from Carnegie, whether not on TV, do you miss the big game build-up at all?
The last couple of months have been quite easy. I've not missed it because no rugby league on, is there? Next week that all changes. But I have to say, my enjoyment from playing, the concern for me moving across was, can I replicate that buzz that I get after playing well in league and winning? And I have to say I can in Union. So that was the big thing for me. You know, whether I'm playing in front of 85,000 or 85, I'd much rather be playing in front of the first one. But it is what it is at the minute. We have to try and generate and build and get better. It was a bit of a culture shock at first, but I knew what I was getting into. I'm happy with the decision I've made. I realise how big the Rhinos are, but we have something to aspire to as a group and as a team and a club. I look forward to watching the Rhinos and enjoying the atmosphere and enjoying being part of that big game, that big match atmosphere throughout the year when I'm able to come with my wife and my kids and enjoy it and support the team like some of the support I've had. So I think when you and Bryan will be able to add to this, but when you get on the field, you forget about all the peripheral stuff. Your focus is on playing well. Your focus is on trying to do your best for the guy next to you. And although you turn up at the ground, and there's nothing better than turning up at Old Trafford on Grand Final night and seeing the razzmatazz, and do you know that stadium's going to be full when you come out and you walk out before the game and your eyes are standing up on the back of your neck and all the fireworks are going. Albeit we don't get that in Kinsale or some of the places I've been, but I still aspire to play at that level, and who knows.
Any more questions at all? Okay, well, I think we've just got a microphone. We'll start with this gentleman, then on to that one.
What do you think of referees? How's your relationship over the years been with referees who the fans love to hate?
That's me, I'll
be. Both of you.
He was the gobby one. Gobby's
come out. Yeah, I mean, I don't get too bothered, but I think it's everyone's entitled to their opinion and how they want to support that different group. I think it can be made far more of. I think you have to respect any environment, and I respect it, whatever league, Union environment it is. You know, Leeds itself, you've got the football there as well. It's a big animal that was very successful and had some tough times. So I don't compare the two. I just let them unfold. As I say, I love the rugby league. I love the element of it. But ultimately, the rival is there, but it's there in any town. So I don't get too caught up in it all. Kev?
Yeah, my view on referees is probably pretty similar to Bruce's. The humans, unlike everybody else, they make individual errors. So I'd like to think, throughout the year, like you probably hear many coaches and players say, they even themselves out. I think the Rhinos in particular, it might be a bit controversial here now, but I reckon 2016, the Rhinos will be refereed quite hard. And I think we faced it on a number of occasions when we've had successful years. The following year, referees pick on every little thing that the successful team do. But I think in the end, when it comes to big games towards the back end of the year, when they have to be 50-50, it works in your favour because you're squeaky clean by that time. So you may see some dubious calls at the start of the year. I think that always happens because they get new guidelines sent down. It might be a bit controversial. I think the Rhinos will be refereed quite hard to start with, but hopefully it'll pay off come the back end of the year when the trophies are won.
Just one thing on rugby union. So an opposition coach can send clips to the referee of what he feels the opposition are doing illegally, but they have to send them to us as well. So I actually get shown what the opposition have sent to the referee, which means that obviously they're worried about certain parts of the game. So they're more focused than that. And ultimately all we do is just address the little elements that he may see. So I think it evens itself out, and I think you've got to take the man out the middle out the way and not get too bothered by him. I think some of the best players, certainly Richie McCaw, said if he makes the same mistake twice, he's not learning. So the referee may have a perceived opinion of going in with him, but I think if you don't adjust to what he's done to you because the opposition coach has highlighted it and you've not taken note of it, i.e. Monday to Friday, because it's been highlighted, then I think you're the dull player, and players sometimes think they're better than the ref, and ultimately he doesn't change his mind very often.
I think there's a gentleman in the middle. We pass the mic over.
I'm sure I'll need it, Gareth, to be honest. Where does your leadership ability come from, guys? Is it nature, nurture? And how can you create that amongst the younger players that Carnegie you've got?
Again, I think I touched on it a little bit earlier. I was always deemed as the one that, out of the two older brothers, it wasn't going to succeed. So from a young age, I learned very quickly to when your dad was going to kick you for doing something wrong, he shut up, he said nothing. Whereas my brothers tend to gob off because they were bigger. So I learned very quickly to be quiet, seen and not heard sort of thing. But as a captain, every team I ever played for, I was fortunate, but I just felt I had a desire that I wanted to succeed. And even now, when I train now with the lads, I still want to, if I put a bad pass out or something, I think my personal standards need to be high. And just because I'm an old codger compared to this lost lot, you know what I mean? I still feel that I've got standards to set. And I think if you set them high enough and others follow that, and I think that's really important that you've given something to follow. And for me, it was just about doing what I do, doing it really well. And then I tried to use others, tried to help them. If you do this for me, I'll try and make it easier for you. And in that mindset, and if I give... Another part has been humble enough to stand up and say, that was my fault, sorry lads, I've let you down. Sometimes you can have a cart, well, it's not my fault, and he gets away with it. And I think I always pride myself on that. If I've made a mistake, even as a coach, if I've made an error, or if I've not coached the team, or I've given them the right info, it's no harm in saying, geez, I've messed up there, lads. That's my bag. I'll take that one. So for me, I think leading is about example. It's not necessarily being the best player or the best, biggest or the fastest or the strongest. Just about being the most efficient and who can keep his high percentages. International rugby, for me, for 10 years, was about being high percentages in everything I'd done. I couldn't do what maybe a Matt Dawson or a Rob Howley or a Joost van der Vestes and George Gregan, whoever it was I was playing against, I sometimes couldn't do what they could do. So I just stuck at the high percentages of everything I could, and I felt if I could do that, I'd give myself a chance.
I think Bryan answered that really well. I think
announced the team the other day, he's in, so he's all
right. as a player, the best thing you can give the team is the best performance possible you can come up with. And I think if you use that as a starting block, you're not always going to get a 10 out of 10 game, but players appreciate how hard you try and how hard you prepare and how hard you work at something. Bryan also mentioned an honesty, having an honesty about what you do. And also what's worked in particular, if you look back at the Rhinos, is being able to empower and share in the qualities that are in the group and around the group. A big inspiration of mine has been Shackleton and his work going back 100 years and what he did. But also having studied and understand the terminology of it now, emotional intelligence, to understand what makes people tick. And if we're talking about trying to educate younger players and how to become better leaders, well, that'd be the thing I suggest, trying to understand each other, know what makes people tick. And you can't do it all yourself. To be able to empower and have a group of you who at different times will be better at delivering certain things is the best way to do it. They don't always hear one voice, but if you can get it coming from 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 people within a dressing room, if we're all on the same path, then you've got a real strength as a group.
Questions? You're over here. I think the microphone's just working. It's
you've outlined the ambitions. Your ambitions are pretty clear. You know, you want promotion, you want to stay there.
What's your biggest challenge to realise that ambition, do you think?
I think at present, for me right now, I think that do we have enough players that really believe they are capable of playing in that league? A lot of players have come down through, they've been in big clubs before, maybe not had a chance, been sort of neglected and told they're not as good as somebody else. So they've come down the level and then they've found a level that they actually compete really well at. And I get frustrated at some of them that they don't really believe that we're good enough this year to not lose a game and go on and win every game from now to the end of the season and get that playoff final and win. Now, that's not arrogance. That's not me saying that we will. I'm just saying, do we actually believe that in 4 months' time, we'll be in that part where we want to be? And the sacrifices that we need to make. And I think some of them are a bit frightened of a sacrifice. They think, well, geez, if I get into that premiership. Now, that we get in there and we play against some of the big teams. As I say, they're spending $7.5 million. That means that they're going to generate the quality of player that might be better. That's fine, but that's only 15 players. They're 15 against our 15. Their 30 against our 30 is considerably better. But on that day, their 15 against our 15, we've got a chance. Bring in the weather, bring in the referee, bring in whatever you may need that day, an off day. They don't respect us, they don't give us a chance. You have chances then. It balances itself out. My challenge right now, in front of all of you, is that does everyone believe? Kev knows the changing room better than I do. I don't know the real ins and outs that go on. I stand up, I talk to them, I give them a view. I try and integrate myself to try and feel what people are like or train with them to get a balance in there, because I still can. When I get another couple of years, I probably can't. But I tend to do that to find out what kind of person they are and how I see them in a tough situation. I give boys a hard time and if I join in. Other ones, I test them. But I'm not there to rubbish them. I'm there to say to them, you had a bad time at Saracens, or you had a bad time at Gloucester or wherever. Well, that's in the past. That you can't do anything about that. But what you can now with this group is change it and try and get there. And if we get there, I may sign somebody else in your position that is a South African that costs me 400 grand, 500 grand. I may. But that's not really your problem at the end of the day. If I choose to do that, don't drop your standards just because it's not what you want. And right now, I think we're on a tipping scale where if we believe, I personally think we'll go on and win this comp. And if everyone has that vision inside them, it doesn't have to be bragged off to these media chaps that hopefully won't tweet that. But
on camera.
Oh, jeez, I forgot. I sorry. It's only a wee camera. It's only a wee people will see it. I believe that, you know, that's my view. But there's a lot of work to do in that time. And I think that the vision and the goal is bigger than me, because there's the investors, the fans, the players themselves is bigger than me. But in the short term, I'm on the short term as in 2 days away on Saturday at London Scottish, we're going to have to dig in deep, because for 75 minutes, the game won't be decided until the last five. And we have to understand that as well. There's no God-given right to win. So we're going to have to dig in deep Saturday. We've played them three times already, 1-2, and we're playing away from home. And we have to understand that. But if we believe, we'll get our rewards. If we dig in through the tough times in the game, I think we can win.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, as always, time has beaten us on these Carnegie conversations. So sorry if you haven't had a chance to ask your question. Thank you so much for being here today. I hope you found it informative and entertaining. And can we just give a thank you to our two guests?